Hey everyone, Mr. Happy here, and welcome to another Opera Omnia video. In this video, we'll be talking about multiplayer. Specifically, we'll do a quick description of how the feature functions, as well as some tips on the current co-op quests. Thanks to Square Enix for sponsoring this video and all the Opera Omnia content thus far on the channel. To see more videos, check the playlist in the description. So, straight to the point. Opera Omnia has quests that allow you to team up with other players to take on tougher challenges. To access this, head to the Events section on the quest map and select Co-op Quests in the menu. This will show you a list of all the currently available co-op quests. Similar to single-player quests, each of them give bonus rewards for first-time completion, as well as completing the quest missions and score threshold. Multiplayer quests are also an excellent source of crystals for upgrading your characters should you exhaust all other options for the day. For most quests, when you select them, you'll be given an option at the bottom to play with a group or to do them solo. Playing solo pretty much replicates your experience with the rest of the game. Select an assist character and defeat all the enemies. When you select group, you are given two options, guest or host. Hosting a multiplayer match will allow you to recruit players on your follow list, or freely recruit random players searching to team up for that mission. The hosted room will automatically make your selected character whichever one held the topmost position in your party structure before entering, but you can use the party option in your menu to change your character, gear, passives, and summon freely. Once two other players join and ready up, you can begin the quest. Keep in mind that hosting a co-op match costs you one Link Bell, a resource you are given 5 of per day. More can be purchased per day with gems, but this is highly discouraged due to the way that playing as a guest actually works. If you select guest, you are thrown into a random host's room that has enabled free recruit, and from here it's the same deal. But participating as a guest will not cost you any Link Bells. This allows you to freely farm co-op quests as long as you are willing to be a guest. Two things to note. One, there are missions that are regularly made available when new co-op quests are made available. So if you're reaching for those score quests, playing as a guest is something you'll probably be doing a lot of. Also, in order to earn credit for the score and mission bonuses for that individual multiplayer quest, you must be the host. So at some point, you'll want to get this done using your own bells. Now, some missions allow a choice between group and solo, while others will only allow for group play. Even with group play being the only option, you can technically still start the mission solo. All you have to do is make the room and start the mission before anyone joins at the cost of one Link Bell. This does put you at a significant disadvantage, though, since one of the major benefits to grouping up is that each player gets their own summon. This allows you to summon 3 times throughout the quest and gives you much better odds at clearing it. Heading in solo just lets you use your one summon, so play nice with others. You even get bonus gems for playing with a unique person for the first time, up to a maximum of 20 unique people. It's 200 gems per first time bonus, so that's just 4,000 gems waiting for you. So now that we've explained a bit about how multiplayer works, let's talk about some of the fights. The level 40 and 45 missions I barely need to explain. The level 40 mission puts you up against an Iron Giant in Wave 1 and a Gaia Behemoth in Wave 3. The level 45 mission puts you up against a Zoo in Wave 1 and a Malboro in Wave 3. You barely need any strategy for these. Executing anything resembling a strategy will just push them over a little bit faster, but they're going to go down fast. Level 50 is where things start to get tricky. The first boss in the level 50 co-op quest is a Sandworm. The basic bravery attack here is non-threatening, though it always starts the fight with its main HP attack, Gravity Spin. He will use this attack so long as he has a moderate amount of bravery that is less than half of his target's HP. Gravity Spin will always do 50% of the current target's HP and damage, and he tends to rotate around and hit everyone with it at least once before going back and hitting a repeat target. Killing him fast or keeping him broken mitigates the chances of you seeing the skill outside of the first time in the fight. Also, under 50% HP, he starts using saliva to counter HP attacks. It lowers your speed, but honestly, barely even matters. Wave 2 is a trash wave, and Wave 3 is a skull dragon. This boss is also present in the level 60 quest, and it's important you understand how he works here before heading over there. The first two turns, the skull dragon will use basic bravery attacks. His attack value is quite high, so watch those breaks. After that, he has 3 potential other attacks. Group Vairaga he will use occasionally to deal bravery damage to the whole team. You'll see that whenever he uses something that's targeting everyone. Lunge is his HP attack, which he usually uses following 2 or 3 basic attacks, and as long as he has some bravery. He won't use it while broken, and will almost always use it if his break ends on the same turn he attacks. It also inflicts bravery poison for several turns. His most deadly attack is Crushing Fangs. This is a 3-hit attack that is unmitigatable. The first two hits will always deal exactly enough bravery damage to bring you down to 0 bravery, while the third attack breaks you and hits very hard. This spikes his bravery close to, if not all the way to max, easily enough to kill most characters. Early on, it can be hard to predict Crushing Fangs, though he usually uses it after several basic attacks and if his bravery is very low. Later on in the fight, he will almost always use this following up a group Viraga. Getting used to the AI and knowing when to expend HP attacks is important to ensuring he doesn't rob a player of all their offense with Crushing Fangs. At 50%, the dragon also fully buffs itself with Ancient Power, gaining more attack, defense, maximum bravery, speed, and even debuff evasion. On the level 50 quest, you probably won't see most of this. Most groups just save all 3 summons for the Skull Dragon, wait until his first 2 turns are over, and then unleash them all back to back to back, with lots of bravery generation and HP attacks. On this level quest, it's almost always enough to kill him. On the level 60 quest, you won't always be so fortunate. Before we talk about the level 60 Skull Dragon though, let's quickly cover the level 55 quest. The first boss there is a red dragon on wave 1. It likes to use Fire Breath and usually opens the fight with it for AoE bravery damage, and also uses fire as a basic attack. Its only really threatening attack is Mega Flash. It'll spend a turn charging up, which you can see when it's targeting itself, and the next attack will randomly hit your party for bravery damage before randomly hitting one of them with an HP attack. If you just break the red dragon during its charge, it can't use Mega Flash, so just do that. There's also a Chimera in wave 3, and he can be a little bit of a pain. You're probably used to fighting Chimeras by now from the Ifrit World of Illusion quest, but for those who haven't fought them yet, here's the deal. The Chimera rotates its attacks between its 3 heads, always going from lion to goat to dragon, left to right. This can also be tracked by looking for an aura around the heads. Whichever one has the aura currently is the one that's attacking. The lion head can use Flame Hoof, Giant Fireballs, or HP attack. The goat head can cast Blizzara, use Lunge — this lunge is a multi-hit bravery attack, not an HP attack — or its HP attack. It can also use a 3-turn HP regen when on the goat's turn. The dragon head uses Thunder Breath for AoE bravery damage and Thundara for single target, though Thunder Breath is what you'll see like 90% of the time. Under 50% HP, Thunder Breath becomes Thunderstorm, which deals significantly more bravery damage. Finally, at 75, 50, and 25%, the Chimera also buffs itself. At 75%, it increases its attack, at 50%, it buffs its defense, and at 25%, it gets a buff that generates over 1,000 bravery per turn the Chimera gets. Your goal here is to try and resist the breaks that come out from the Dragon Head's AoEs and the Giant Fireballs from the Lion Head, the 2 most deadly bravery attacks. You can attempt to bait out HP attacks by not breaking the Chimera when its Lion and Goat Heads are using up their turns to try and make for more time to use HP attacks. You can choose to run a somewhat supporty team and mitigate or dispel the various buffs that come out, or go for a full offensive team and burn down the Chimera when it's under 50% HP with a summon. Both work, and I prefer the second strategy if you have powerful physical attackers. It's also worth mentioning that the Chimera is weak to fire, so as a summon, Ifrit's usually a pretty good choice here. The level 60 quest is actually a Chimera, followed immediately by a Skull Dragon. For this quest, I highly recommend going either 1 support and 2 heavy offensive characters, or 3 fully heavy offensive characters. Having a heavily offensive team ensures that if and when enemy bravery values get super high, the whole team has skills to shave off enemy bravery. It also helps ensure that you don't have to deal with back-to-back-to-back Crushing Fangs on the Skull Dragon, because you'll usually kill him before he gets to do that. Luckily, there are plenty of viable characters for stuff like this. Zidane is a personal favorite, as his Stellar Circle is great for slowing down the turn rate of the enemies. Squall is really good for chipping away at bravery and getting extra turns in occasionally if your crystal strength is high enough. Cloud is good for the occasional paralyzed, the launch on finishing touch definitely helps with some safety, and if you have Crimson Edge, dispelling the Chimera buffs or portions of Ancient Power. Bart is incredibly strong at countering Crushing Fangs, as his Mastered Missiles attack shaves 50% of the enemy's bravery. Tifa's great for her Beat Rush attack, especially on the Skull Dragon. Setzer can be strong if you can hold on to Freeze Solid until the Skull Dragon and try to use it right before Crushing Fangs. Dark Knight Cecil can abuse his repeated launches to either generate a lot of bravery, shave a lot of bravery, or execute high HP attack combos. Vaughn is just great at everything. All the supports are generally viable as well, though bringing two usually makes for trouble towards the end of the Skull Dragon. Basically, tons of characters have a lot of merit here. I know I named a bunch, but one big thing to remember is you probably want pretty high crystal levels before going into the level 60 co-op quest, unless you're bringing a support character. Honestly, even with a support character, you'd be at least close to your 40s on crystal strength and level 50 on the character itself. And that's a wrap for my multiplayer introduction video. Due to the increased difficulty of some of these encounters, it's hard to talk about them in excruciating detail here, especially when it comes to manipulating their AI to get them to do kind of the things you want them to do. You heard me mention certain conditions in which you can usually bait out certain skills. I highly recommend joining the discussions around event and co-op bosses over on the Opera Omnia Reddit Discord, as frequent discussions about manipulating boss AI and people looking for groups are available there. I'll include a link to that in the description as well. Anyway, thank you for watching this video. Be sure to like, favorite, subscribe, and share, and stay tuned for more Opera Omnia content on the channel. I'll see you all next time, and until then, take care.